Already in conversation with Alison Moyet now. Very good morning.
Very good morning.
Should we do the official introduction?
Yes, go ahead.
20 million record sales to her name and a voice which can carry off any song with ease, from punk to blues to dance floor diva. Alison Moyet has covered it all, done it all. I mean, covered it all. It's all original stuff. Now, in a sense, she's returning to her musical roots.
She's back with an album that's been described as a musical resurrection. Alison's here now. Very good morning.
Thank you very much. We're
going to take a moment. Do you mind if we do a bit of a look back? We often do this to people.
No, I do. I haven't got my glasses on, so it's not.
Oh, you can't see it anyway.
No, you can hear it. Here we go. Well, it's fantastic to see you. Alison, as we look back, what people will most notice, of course, is how different you look now.
Isn't that depressing, though? Isn't it depressing that, you know, you sit there and think you can have a 30-year career and all the people are really interested in the way you look, you know?
Well, but that's part of the industry, isn't it? And that's presumably part of the challenge of being in this showbiz music industry.
I don't know, because I was never someone that could ever trade off of that, you know, and I never did, and consequently I've never had the desire to, you know. So, I look the way that I look, and, you know, and I'm glad that there are people who listen to music for their ears rather than for their eyes, you know.
Exactly. And the music, obviously, you're back now with a new album.
Yeah.
We talk about a resurrection, but you've still been making music.
Oh, yeah, I've been doing... You know, it's like you have a long career. Like, you know, mine's been like 30 years, and it's, you know, you're going to have a sine wave. There are going to be times where people are interested and where they couldn't give a toss. You know, that's basically what it is. But you're still as active, and you still have records that you feel are stronger than others that come at, you know, your prominent times. So, I'm a musician. You know, I'm not a celebrity. I'm a working musician. Mm.
So chart us. Give us a little kind of a chart. So you have this extraordinary success. You're very young.
Yeah.
And everybody's in love with you. They love the voice. They love everything that comes with it. Well, I mean, what happens after that? What was the start of the point at which you kind of, I mean, from our point of view, we say sort of disappeared. Clearly, you're just leading your life. But what was the trajectory there? What happened?
Well, I think that the problem for someone like me is I became famous before I really knew what kind of artist I was. What I did know is that I was always interested in exploring. And so, you know, there are times that you make a record just out of interest and it turns out to be a massive commercial success. And that kind of fixes you in a particular time. One of the things that I find hard as an artist, constantly having to look back, is that you have a different voice at 50 than you do at 20. And I don't mean... You know, the way that you sound, but just the messages that you want to put across. And so anyway, there came a point in time when the record company realised I was a bit of a cash cow, and quite understandably wanted me to carry on in that trajectory. And that wasn't of interest for me. You know, I don't want to reproduce things. I would much rather try something different and fail at it than just, you know, flog a dead horse.
So you went into a sort of battle with the record company execs then, did you?
Well, to a certain degree. And like I say, you know, I don't want to blame anyone else, because I'd say all the mistakes I've ever made in my life have been my own, absolutely. And I can understand it, because it's really expensive to market a record. So why would they want to give the same push on something that they know that they're not going to get away? And so I have no bitterness towards them. I think the only upset that I had with them was during a period when it was like, when I was saying to them, I can't make the record that you want me to make. Yeah. I've made you millions of pounds. Why don't you just let me go and fail elsewhere, you know? And they're too frightened that you are going to have a result somewhere else, and so they don't let you work and hang on to you. That was the only depressing thing about it.
And your whole mantra is that you live in the now. I think that's very much how you live it, isn't it? I think we're going to see the new single.
Oh, yeah.
So
Love
let's have a look
Supreme.
At that.
Supreme, yeah. Here we go. You mentioned that your voice is different. I mean, do you feel that your voice is richer, has a different tone? How is it
changed? I think it's all of those. You know, I think it's all of those things, and it's also about choices that you make. You know, sometimes people imagine that you can't sing a certain way. You can still sing that way. It's just that you choose not to. But more than that, more than the sound of the voice, it's about what you want to say. You know, there are songs like, for example, An Invisible, which I did years ago, which I absolutely can't sing anymore. And I can't do it because, you know, it kind of carries on from that Janis Joplin ideal that I had when I was younger, which is all, you know, French lieutenant's woman, it's all about bleating, you know. And you get to a certain age when you go, oh, flipping hell, stop moaning, it's a bloke, kick him into touch. And you just, you know, you can't engage with it anymore. And the one thing that I do insist on when I'm performing live is that I'm going to engage and be honest about my performance, you know.
I find it fascinating because you're obviously such a forthright person and you clearly like engaging.
Yeah.
But as I understand, there was a period of time when you effectively locked yourself away. Is that true?
Well,
that
it is. Yeah. It's about growing up, you know. And for me, I was always a black sheep. I was always kind of like left to my own devices and people ignored me. And it's quite shocking when you become famous. And you have to remember, it's not something that I was aspiring to. I never wanted to become a pop star. And I feel self-conscious saying that because it sounds, again, like I'm moaning about it. I'm really grateful because had it not been for that time, I wouldn't have been in a position to say no. I wouldn't be in the position that I am in now, where the only deals that record companies wanted to give me were for covers albums, which I absolutely didn't want to do, and so I made this record myself and then took it to a label. And I wouldn't have been able to do that without the success that.
But there was a time when you just you did sort of remove yourself.
I did, yeah. Because it's odd. It's just, you know, being famous is a really odd existence. It's bizarre, you know, and it's bonkers when, you know, you could be standing somewhere and there's someone a foot away from you, like talking to their mates about you, like you're like you're on the telly, you know. You kind of become like a cartoon character, you know. Hello, I'm here.
Did you react to that badly, do you think? I mean, in a personal sense, did you find it awkward with people when they were doing that? Did you?
Yeah, I found it really awkward because, you know, I never bought into that whole kind of stuff, you know. And again, that saved me because I was always a cheap date, you know. I don't have expensive tastes, and you know, and I don't move in those circles. And my mates were the mates that I went to school with, and you know you know, regular walks of life. So it's just a bizarre existence when you're just with your regular mates and you're singled out.
But you are famous and you're recognisable. So how do you deal with that now?
Well, it becomes easier. I mean, you know, when I was young, you know, I was, all over the place and everyone recognised me. When you get to a certain age, it's the people that are interested in what you do that connect with you. And that's nice. I like that. But general kids aren't going to chase after you just because you've been on the telly. And that's a brilliant place to be.
Yeah, and you've got kids yourself, and they're great levellers, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone always says that.
Yeah.
Are they, what sort of ages are they?
28, 26 and 17.
Okay. I said kids, I was thinking little ones. Yeah, growing up.
No, exactly. Now I've got some space now. Now right. I'm laughing.
And are you going to do live stuff
yeah, yeah,
now
I've
as well?
Yeah, I've got a big extensive tour, touring all the way through the autumn. But, you know, I've toured pretty much all through anyway. It's my favourite thing.
Lovely to see you here this
morning.
Yeah,
thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Brilliant to see you. The album is The Minutes.
Yes.
The single is Love Reigns Supreme. It's out now. And the nationwide tour begins in September.
Yes, you are.
Good luck.
Thank you.
That's it for us this morning. Programme is back at 6. Richard Madeley will be here.
Yeah, and Louise as well. Back on Centre Court too. Have a lovely day today, whatever you're doing. Goodbye.